empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same.
Good evening and welcome to Bishop Hannington Church. My name is Ben Martin. I'm the curate here. It's lovely to see you here and to welcome you as we continue in our series looking at the story of Joseph. We're going to be hearing later on about that continuing effort of how the brothers will go back to Joseph in Egypt to find out what happened next. And it's a great reminder that through all of the threads of life, the Lord is at work. The Lord's at work through each and every part of our lives this evening. So when we come to church, we don't leave our problems and our baggage at home. We come and bring them before the Lord our God. So with that in mind, let's begin in prayer and then we'll sing together. Father, we thank you that you're a God who knows how we're made. We thank you that you're a God who knows what our world is like. And we thank you that we have that confidence that you are a God who is able to work in and through all those things. And we pray this evening as we come together, as we sing your praises, as we hear your words, that you may indeed lift up our heads and our hearts to you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to begin by singing two songs, so please stand.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Please do take your seats. We've just sung at the very end there, my heart could not tell, my words could not tell, even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart. We're going to say some words of confession now, words that we say not because we must, but because we may. A word we say in recognition of the debt of love that Jesus has paid for us. And we're going to use the words based of Psalm 103. I'll say part, and there's a response for us, for you as well to make. In the middle, there'll be a short period of silence for us to reflect and remember. But all the words you need will be based on the screens. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great kindness. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our wickedness. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy upon those who fear him. Say together, Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he set our sins from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so is the Lord merciful towards those who fear him. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Father, we thank you that even though you know us completely, you forgive us utterly. That as far as the east is from the west, so our sins are cast away. Lord, may we remember that. And hold to that this day and always. Amen. Just before we go on, there's a few bits of church family news to draw your attention. The first is just to say that at the back of church, we've got this little book, this Lent book that we're pushing. So Lent is a bit like Advent. It's a season to prepare and get ready. It's a bit longer than Advent, which is why it's a little bit bigger that's going on. But it's a wonderful opportunity just to spend a short time each day getting ready, preparing, not just physically, but preparing spiritually for Easter. It's by the same author that we used in Advent, Sinclair Ferguson, and it's just £6 at the back. You can pay by bank transfer later on. So if you want to take a copy and do a bank transfer later, that's absolutely fine. So please just grab a copy. It'd be a wonderful resource for us all to be using. And why not chat about it? Lent starts on Wednesday, so have a go and talk about that. If you're part of a small group, then in Lent, we're going to be setting aside what we normally do and just using this little book here called Talking to Our Father, Praying and Living the Lord's Prayer. An opportunity, again, just to focus on communicating with our great God and what that means to pray with him. And we're doing that during our Lent period. So if you're a small group leader and you haven't got one of these, please do grab one from the back. So that's for small group leaders, grab one of them. And finally, just to remind you that the welcome lunch is coming up on the 5th of March. If you'd like to come along, it'll be a good opportunity if you've joined the church family or are thinking of joining the church family to come along to have a little glimpse as to what life at the church is about. The 5th of March. Sign up if you can. It's just helpful to know for catering purposes. Great. But now I'm going to invite John Haynes to come up. Give him a round of applause. What's going on? Grab the mic. There we go. John, I should probably say welcome back, shouldn't I, really? Because you were part of the church family way back when. You're Sue and Colin's boy.
That's right. Yes, Sue and Colin's boy. Kathy's brother. That is something that will go around with me for the rest of my life. And a joy.
So just roughly, so what ages from when through were you kind of here?
Born here. Well, not here.
Well, that's that bit over there.
I was baptised here as a baby. I came through creche and scramblers and climbers, explorers, pathfinders, KO.
Brilliant.
And then left when I went to university at the age of 19.
So KO, so we've got some KO folk here. So you've kind of done the complete KO thing. I don't think Stephen was leading KO then, but could be wrong.
He's been around a while, but no, not quite.
But what was KO like? And looking back now, why was it so important and so good for you?
Yeah. I probably need to be careful what I say because some people will remember me from back then. Okay, it was great. I think you were treated as an adult. You got people expected you to be able to learn about Jesus, wanted you to learn about Jesus, knew that that is the best thing for you, and so it opened the Bible with you. It was great to see people my age who trusted Jesus and who wanted to make that show in their lives. It was great to be able to invite friends into that, so you weren't trying to you weren't the only weird person at school trying to tell people about Jesus, but you could say, come and see some of my friends who also believe this. And I think part of being treated as an adult meant that you can make mistakes. As you're growing up, you do all sorts of stupid things, but I found I could come on a Sunday evening, come for a Bible study during the week, and they would talk about those things and would twist my heart a bit, help me see what am I doing, why am I behaving like this, why is Jesus so much better than anything else on offer.
Great. And then we kind of sort of fast forward through university work, Vicar College, curacy in Eastbourne.
Yeah.
And now you are where?
Now in Leipzig.
And where is Leipzig?
In East Germany.
East Germany.
Yeah, it's a very natural progression, so watch out.
Eastbourne, East Germany.
Yeah, okay. Eastbourne, East Germany, yeah.
And what? Give us a flavour of what is life like, just generally, in Leipzig?
Leipzig is very similar to Brighton. It is a very liberal city. It's bigger, so it's 600,000 people. It's a big university. There's a great music scene. I play drums, and so but it's a classical music scene in Leipzig, so I'm not welcome. It is a green city, so there's lots of open space. I think one of the things that's really struck me is how much time people put into their day. And they put effort into the simple things, going for a walk, enjoying coffee, but not just working themselves to the bone, which, having been in London for a number of years, it's very easy to think life is all about work. And there's so much more to it than that.
And what sort of things would you be doing for fun as a family?
I hate to say it, I've become a real cliche. I enjoy walking the dog. We've got three kids. They are 6, 8, and 9 now. It's great seeing them grow up. Gabby and I write music, and we try and do some of that when we have time. So she sings. We sort of fumble our way through various instruments. We play games. We just enjoy people, and so hanging out with people, with friends from church, and getting to know neighbours.
And you mentioned church. What is church there?
So church. So I'm an ordained Anglican minister, just like you. We're at college together. So church is Leipzig English Church. We are a Church of England church in the city of Leipzig in the centre, and we're there to reach out to the English-speaking international community. That means we have all sorts of different people who come. Some come because it's the Anglican church in the city. Some come because it's the English-speaking church in the city, and they just want to have a break from speaking German for a bit. Some come because they are really convicted by the same values that we have. We love to open the Bible and give time to hearing God speak. We gather together to worship and have that heart to reach out to other English speakers in the city with the only news that's going to make their life better, the only with Jesus who is the hope of the world.
Brilliant. And what are the things that we can sort of, what are the challenges that you face and the encouragements, I suppose, to you?
Thank you. Challenges, I think there's two challenges that come to mind instantly are the number of children we have, which is a real joy, but we are very much running out of room for kids at the moment. Part of that challenge is also the Leipzig is a city centre church, and it's an English international sort of a bit of an expat feel to it, but not in the traditional sense. So people aren't there necessarily for years and years. And so how do you equip them? How do you build them up? How do you send them off loving Jesus better, wanting to live and speak for him wherever they go next, making wise choices with their lives?
Great. Yeah. So as a church, which is wonderful to hear kind of part of the bigger Anglican family, so yeah. Church of England Church in Germany, how can we be praying for, I suppose, for the church and for you at the moment?
Thanks. I think it would be great to pray that as a church family, we have a real heart to reach fellow English speakers. It's very easy when you're there, this is your break in the week to speak English, to enjoy one another. It's very easy to become internalized, and we want to be thinking, okay, God has put us in this city to reach out, to speak of him. The only reason we are here today is because God is merciful. And he hasn't come back as judge. And so I think having that heart for people in the city of Leipzig to love Jesus, to trust Jesus. I think I'm an Anglican, but we at the same time, we're a very broad church. Because we're in an international church, not everyone comes because it's the local parish church. And so I think pray for unity. Pray that we'd be wise and loving in our disagreements. And I think as many of us are looking on at things going on in the wider Church of England at the moment and sort of questioning what is going on, pray that we'd speak wisely, pray that we'd have a hunger and a desire to sit under God's word, that we would act. It's very easy to be isolated, but we're not. We're part of the global church. It's great to be back. I've come back a few times over the years. And knowing that we've been looking at Philippians this morning in our church in Eastbourne we were visiting, and Paul says how we all share in God's grace together, That is true for us in Leipzig, it's true for you here, it's true for our sending church in London. And I think just knowing we are part of one global body, we want to, when one part hurts, all of us hurt, and we want to act together, we want to see each other built up and trust Jesus.
And for you as a family?
We need to speak German. We have some in the home. Our children are rapidly outpacing Gabby and I. So they go to the local German school, and they are thriving there. I'm a bit slower. So please pray for that. Please pray for visas for Gabby and the children. Mine came through very quickly. Gabby and the children's has been slightly more complicated. We think it's nearly there, but it'd just be nice to have that aspect of life admin done. So we moved in July. We've had months and months of administration that needs to be done.
Great. Can we pray now?
Please.
Okay. Loving Father, we thank you that we are a united body of Christians, not just in terms of Anglicanism, but actually all those who know and love the Lord Jesus. And we thank you for John and Gabby and the family. Thank you for going over to Leipzig. And thank you for being willing to follow your call there. And we pray that day by day they may know your hand upon them. We pray very practically, Lord, that you'd help them with the language and to grapple with that, and also for the visas to come in. But Lord, we also pray that as a church and as a family, they'd have that real passion and vision to be reaching out the good news of Jesus, particularly to the English speakers. We pray for opportunities. We pray for wisdom about how to train those who are going out to other places, and wisdom to know how to deal with the children and the number of children and where to put them. But Father, we pray that just as we seek to contend for the gospel here in Hove, you may help them to hold out the good work, good news of your son to the people of Leipzig. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks very much, John. We're going to stand and sing again about that same hope that we have. What is our only hope in life and death? It is Christ. Please stand.
Right. unto the grave, what will we sing? Christ, he lives, Christ, he lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with him, then we will rise to meet the Lord, then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy, when Christ is ours forevermore. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope's praise eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope and life and death. Christ, our hope in life and death.
Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. As you remain standing, let us declare these words of Christ, our life. We say together,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please take your seats. So I should have just mentioned that John has got these little prayer letters at the back. If you'd like to grab one, please do take one. It's got some email and stuff to sign up for more. So please grab one at the end of the service if you'd like to. But now Vicky's going to come and bring us our reading, which begins on page 48, Genesis 43.
Good evening. This evening's reading is taken from Genesis chapters 43 and 44, and as Ben said, can be found on page 48 of the Church Bibles, or you can follow along on the screens. So starting at chapter 43. Now the famine was still severe in the land, so when they had eaten all the grain they had brought from Egypt, their father said to them, "Go back and buy us a little more food." But Judah said to him, "The man warned us solemnly, 'You will not see my face again unless your brother is with you.' If you will send our brother along with us, we will go down and buy food for you. But if you will not send him, we will not go down, because the man said to us, 'You will not see my face again unless your brother is with you.'" Israel asked, "Why did you bring this trouble on me by telling the man you had another brother?" They replied, "The man questioned us closely about ourselves and our family. 'Is your father still living?' he asked us. 'Do you have another brother?' We simply answered his questions. How are we to know he would say, 'Bring your brother down here?'" Then Judah said to Israel, his father, "Send the boy along with me, and we will go at once, so that we and you, our children, may live and not die. I myself will guarantee his safety. You can hold me personally responsible for him. If I do not bring him back to you and set him here before you, I will bear the blame before you all my life. As it is, if we had not delayed, we could have gone and returned twice." Then their father Israel said to them, "If it must be, then do this. Put some of the best products of the land in your bags and take them down to the man as a gift, a little balm and a little honey, some spices and myrrh, some pistachio nuts and almonds. Take double the amount of silver with you, for you must return the silver that was put back into the mouths of your sacks. Perhaps it was a mistake. Take your brother also and go back to the man at once, and may God Almighty grant you mercy before the man, so that he will let your other brother and Benjamin come back with you. As for me, if I am bereaved, I am bereaved. So the men took the gifts and doubled the amount of silver, and Benjamin also. They hurried down to Egypt and presented themselves to Joseph. When Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to the steward of his house, "Take these men to my house, slaughter an animal, and prepare a meal. They are to eat with me at noon." The man did as Joseph told him and took the men to Joseph's house. Now the men were frightened when they were taken to his house. They thought, "We were brought here because of the silver that was put back into our sacks the first time. He wants to attack us and overpower us and seize us as slaves and take our donkeys." So they went up to Joseph's steward and spoke to him at the entrance to the house. "We beg your pardon, our lord," they said. "We came down here the first time to buy food, but at the place where we stopped for the night, we opened our sacks, and each of us found his silver, the exact weight, in the mouth of his sack. So we have brought it back with us. We have also brought additional silver with us to buy food. We don't know who put the silver in our sacks." "It's all right," he said. "Don't be afraid. Your God, the God of your father, has given you treasure in your sacks. I received your silver." Then he brought Simeon out to them. The steward took the men into Joseph's house, gave them water to wash their feet, and provided fodder for their donkeys. They prepared their gifts for Joseph's arrival at noon, because they had heard that they were to eat there. When Joseph came home, they presented to him the gifts they had brought into the house, and they bowed down before him to the ground. He asked them how they were, and then he said, "How is your aged father you told me about? Is he still living?" They replied, "Your servant, our father, is still alive and well." And they bowed down, prostrating themselves before him. As he looked about and saw his brother Benjamin, his own mother's son, he asked, "Is this your youngest brother, the one you told me about?" And he said, "God be gracious to you, my son." Deeply moved at the sight of his brother, Joseph hurried out and looked for a place to weep. He went into his private room and wept there. After he'd washed his face, he came out and, controlling himself, said, "Serve the food." They served him by himself, the brothers by themselves, and the Egyptians who ate with them by themselves, because Egyptians could not eat with Hebrews, for that is detestable to Egyptians. The men had been seated before him in the order of their ages, from the firstborn to the youngest, and they looked at each other in astonishment. When portions were served to them from Joseph's table, Benjamin's portion was 5 times as much as anyone else's. So they feasted and drank freely with him. Now Joseph gave these instructions to the steward of his house: "Fill the men's sacks with as much food as they can carry, and put each man's silver in the mouth of his sack. Then put my cup, the silver one, in the mouth of the youngest one's sack, along with the silver for his grain." And he did as Joseph said. As morning dawned, the men were sent on their way with the donkeys. They had not gone far from the city when Joseph said to his steward, "Go after those men at once, and when you catch up with them, say to them, 'Why have you repaid good with evil? Isn't this the cup my master drinks from and also uses for divination? This is a wicked thing you have done.'" When he caught up with them, he repeated these words to them. But they said to him, "Why does my lord say such things? Far be it for your servants to do anything like that. We even brought back to you from the land of Canaan the silver we found inside the mouths of our sacks. So why would we steal silver or gold from your master's house? If any of your servants is found to have it, he will die, and the rest of us will become my lord's slaves." "Very well," then he said, "let it be as you say. Whoever is found to have it will become my slave. The rest of you will be free from blame." Each of them quickly lowered his sack to the ground and opened it. Then the steward proceeded to search, beginning with the eldest and ending with the youngest, and the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. At this, they tore their clothes. Then they all loaded their donkeys and returned to the city. Joseph was still in the house when Judah and his brothers came in, and they threw themselves to the ground before him. Joseph said to them, "What is this you have done? Don't you know that a man like me can find things out by divination?" "What can we say to you, my lord?" Judah replied. "What can we say? How can we prove our innocence? God has uncovered your servant's guilt. We are now my lord's slaves, we ourselves and the one who was found to have the cup." But Joseph said, "Far be it for me to do such a thing. Only the man who is found to have the cup will become my slave. The rest of you go back to your father in peace." Then Judah went up to him and said, "Pardon your servant, my lord. Let me speak a word to you, my lord. Do not be angry with your servant, though you are equal to Pharaoh himself. My lord asked his servants, 'Do you have a father or a brother?' And we answered, 'We have an aged father, and there is a young son born to him in his old age. His brother is dead, and he is the only one of his mother's sons left, and his father loves him.' Then you said to your servants, 'Bring him down to me so I can see him for myself.' And we said to my lord, 'The boy cannot leave his father. If he leaves him, his father will die.' But you told your servants, 'Unless your youngest brother comes down with you, you will not see my face again.' When we went back to your servant, my father, we told him what my lord had said. Then our father said, 'Go back and buy a little more food.' But we said, 'We cannot go down. Only if our youngest brother is with us will we go. We cannot see the man's face unless our youngest brother is with us.' Your servant, my father, said to us, 'You know that my wife bore me two sons. One of them went away from me. And I said, he has surely been torn to pieces, and I haven't seen him since. If you take this one from me too, and harm comes to him, you will bring my grey head down to the grave in misery. So now, if the boy is not with us when I go back to your servant, my father, and if my father, whose life is closely bound up with the boy's life, sees that the boy isn't there, he will die. Your servants will bring the grey head of our father down to the grave in sorrow. Your servant guaranteed the boy's safety to my father. I said, if I do not bring him back to you, I will bear the blame before you, my father, all my life. Now then, please let your servant remain here as my lord's slave in place of the boy, and let the boy return with his brothers. How can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? No, do not let me see the misery that will come down on my father."
Vicky, thank you. You read that beautifully. It was a long reading to give you, and you've done a fantastic job with it. Thank you. Do you hate it when preachers try to make themselves look relevant by quoting from some recent sort of film or song or trend? Does that really annoy you? Well, what if I were to mention a film that's 30 years and 17 days old? Would that be okay? It's certainly not current, is it? I don't even know, KA, whether you guys will have seen this film, which is twice most of your ages. But on the 2nd of February 1993, the film Groundhog Day hit cinemas for the first time. Now, as I'm sure you know, the 2nd of February is Groundhog Day. And the plot of the movie revolves around Bill Murray, who's a weather presenter, who is sent to observe the behavior of Punxsutawney Phil, a groundhog in the town of Punxsutawney, where the idea is if he sees his own shadow, then there's going to be a load more winter. But, well, anyway, the details aren't that important, are they? And I can't remember them. The film has given a phrase into the English language, which is Groundhog Day, the idea of a day that is just like the day before, and when the next day is going to be just the same and the same and the same and the same. Because Bill Murray wakes up the next morning and What's playing on the radio sounds weirdly familiar. It's I Got You, Babe by Sonny and Cher. In fact, I think this film holds the world record for the most playings of the song I Got You, Babe by Sonny and Cher, by some distance. Anyway, he wakes up in the morning, he hears I Got You, Babe by Sonny and Cher. He then hears the same banter on the radio that he heard the day before. He thinks this is very strange, and he goes out and realizes that it is the day before. And he's just stuck in this time loop running through the 2nd of February every day. And no matter what he does in the day, he goes to bed and he wakes up in the morning and it's just the same day and he lives it over again. Now, I wonder whether, like me, as you listened to chapters 43 and 44, you thought, this is a bit Groundhog Day. It feels like we've been here before. Wasn't it last week that Joseph's brothers went down to Egypt to buy grain from him, and they went back and there was silver found in the necks of their sacks, and then they went back to their father, and it all seems to be the same. The things that happen here are so similar. They go back down to Egypt, they bow down before Joseph, his dreams are fulfilled again, he weeps again. And it just goes on and on, so many of the same things. I think I mentioned last week, I know some of you probably weren't here last week, and some of you probably weren't awake by this point, but I mentioned last week that this is the point in the musical where I am generally completely lost and thinking, why are we, what's going on? I really do find that this section rather drags. And perhaps that's how you feel as we come to this reading. You think, this does sound really like what we've just been through. What's the point of this Groundhog Day? Well, as we look at it, I think it's important to recognize that, yes, there is a lot of repetition. And at the end of chapter 44, you get the repetition of the beginning of chapter 43. Judah, who makes a speech to Jacob at the beginning of chapter 43, kind of recounts that speech to Joseph at the end of chapter 44. And there's lots of similar things in between. But this isn't just an accident, and it's not just that the author of Genesis kind of, you know, got stuck on cut and paste mode, and it's all kind of, you know, chunks of familiar text thrown together, because this is incredibly intricate and detailed. Let me just give you some examples of how this is really subtly done. The first thing is the use of the phrase, the man. So you see it for the first time in this passage in chapter 43, verse 3, when Jacob says to the brothers, back you go back to Egypt, get us some more food. Judah says, the man warned us solemnly, you'll not see my face again until your brother is with you. And actually that phrase, the man, just keeps coming back all the way through. So it's there again in verse 5. But if you will not send him, we will not go down, because the man said to us, you will not see my face again unless your brother is with you. And it's actually sort of slightly comic, the way that Judah is referring to his own brother as the man, in the way that generally, in English at least, only three-year-olds ever refer to people. The man said, the man did this, the man pointed over there. But all the way through, so then again, verse 7, they replied, the man questioned us. Sorry, verse 6, Israel asked, why did you bring this trouble on me, telling the man you had another brother? They replied, the man questioned us. And on it goes and on it goes until you get to verse 15. So up till verse 15, you've got the brothers and they're talking about the man. When you get to verse 15, suddenly the brothers are the men and they're talking about Joseph. So Joseph is then known by name and the brothers are called the men. And so very subtly, Moses, let's call him Moses, the writer of Genesis, because that's who it is, he is sort of helping you to see that there's this problem with unrecognition, but there's also this thing of kind of being home and away, this thing of being away from their land. They're the strangers in Egypt. Joseph is the stranger to them, or so they think. In Egypt, they're the strangers. And so then from verse 15 onwards, they're the men. So verse 17, I need my specs to see the little numbers. The man did as Joseph told him and took the men to Joseph's house. Now, the men were frightened. So there's this very subtle, very carefully woven narrative where the way language is being used and the way repetition is being used is telling you something. It's drawing you into the story and telling you things about what's actually going on for these actual people in the moment. And then you have the brothers, the men as they are now in verse 15. They get really scared because Joseph invites them round his house. It is quite like little children, actually, isn't it? The man's invited us to his house. And they're scared. Look what they say, verse 18. Now the men were frightened when they were taken to his house. They thought, we were brought here because of the silver that was put back into our sacks the first time. He wants to attack us and overpower us and seize us as slaves and steal our donkeys. And it's deliberately funny. Like, who's worried about a donkey if you've just been kidnapped and made a slave for the rest of your life? And they'll take our donkeys. And so then what the steward does is he takes them into Joseph's house, and the first thing he does is gives them water to wash their feet and provides fodder for their donkeys. He's not stealing their donkeys, he's looking after their donkeys. And then when they leave in chapter 44, verse 3, the men were sent on their way with their donkeys. The donkeys are a kind of light touch on the way through to sort of help you to see that there's something ridiculous about what's going on. There's an element of farce to all of this. The brothers are terrified that Joseph is looking for a way to do them in. They're terrified when they find their silver in their sacks in chapter 42. They're terrified when they're treated like VIPs, because there must be some trick. They're invited to number 10 Downing Street for dinner. That's what happens. And they think the only reason he could possibly do this is because he wants to take us as slaves. He's going to do us in. He's going to beat us and enslave us. When what actually happens is that they're treated like VIPs in the house of the second most powerful man in Egypt. And there's something that Judah says in chapter 44, verse 18, that I think just gives us an insight into the psychology of the brothers. Why is it that they constantly think that something is going to happen, that something is going to go wrong? Chapter 44, verse 16, Judah says, "What can we say to my Lord?" Judah replied, "What can we say? How can we prove our innocence? God has uncovered your servant's guilt. We are now your slaves. We ourselves and the one who was found to have the cup." They were scared that Joseph was going to enslave them, but strikingly, in the end, when Judah is confronted with what's happened with Benjamin, he actually says, "God has uncovered our guilt. And we deserve to be your slaves." And there's kind of irony and farce in all of this, because whilst they've been terrified that Joseph is going to do something bad to them, they've got no idea how much they deserve Joseph to do something bad to them. And that's all the way through it as well. So they sold Joseph into slavery for 12 shekels of silver. And every time they try to give Joseph silver, they keep getting it back. They can't get rid of the silver. It's a bit like Judas. They cannot get rid of their silver. It's like the spot on Lady Macbeth's hand. The brothers have got a profoundly guilty conscience. Proverbs 28, verse 1 says, "The wicked flee when no one pursues them." Everything that happens to them, they think maybe now's the time when we're going to get it, when we're going to get what's coming to us. And the irony of it all is that the one who is doing to them so much better than they deserve, the one who keeps treating them absurdly well, giving them back their money when they've paid for corn, welcoming them into his house, which is, you know, the sort of most prestigious residence in Egypt, every time he blesses them, they think he's going to curse them, even though he's the one who, if they really knew who he was, they'd really expect him to curse them, and yet he is determined to bless them. That's the first thing to notice. The brothers are saddled with a powerfully guilty conscience because of what happened with Joseph. Do you remember chapter 42, what Reuben says? And chapter 42, verse 21, they said to one another, "Surely we're being punished because of our brother. We saw how distressed he was when he pleaded with us for his life, but we would not listen. That's why this distress has come on us." Reuben said, "Didn't I tell you not to sin against the boy, but you wouldn't listen? Now we must give an accounting for his blood." And again, the irony in it all, they don't think Joseph can understand them. They've got no idea who he is. He's speaking to them through an interpreter. In front of their brother, they are talking plainly about what they did to him. And the guilt of it, 24 years later, is still with them. And woven through this intricate story, you see in Joseph a glimpse of the face of God. He is the clearest echo in the Bible so far, getting towards the end of the first book of it, of how Jesus treats us. He comes into a world which he made, but which does not recognize him. And though we should have received him, we murdered him. And yet in that very act of his death, he redeemed a people for himself and gave them eternal life. Now, I mentioned Groundhog Day. But actually, in many ways, verses 43 and 44 are more like a sort of strange mirror image of a film like The Joker or Batman. It's become a kind of familiar idea, hasn't it? The origin story. And origin story movies tend to be that you observe the sort of trauma and catastrophe that's happened in a character's life early on that has then sort of twisted them out of shape and made them into the rather broken and often dangerous individual that they are. And a film like The Joker is horrifically disturbing in that kind of way. But this origin story is the origin story of Judah. I wonder if you remember back in chapter 37, it's Judah who says, "Let's sell him." And so all of this sort of circles around to Judah getting in trouble around silver. That's no coincidence. Judah's the one who wants to sell his brother as a slave. Judah, chapter 38, is the one who sleeps with his daughter-in-law because he thinks she's a prostitute. But then in chapter 43, Judah is the one who steps up, who becomes de facto the leading brother amongst the 12, the one who persuades Israel to let them take Benjamin down into Egypt. And then, at the end of chapter 44, it is Judah who, confronted by the horror of Benjamin, you see this kind of redemptive arc in his life, he becomes the one who says to Joseph, "Take me as a slave." and send Benjamin home to his father. Do you see how the story's come full circle? He's gone from selling his brother as a slave to being willing to offer himself as a slave in place of his brother. Now, why does he want to sell his brother as a slave in chapter 37? Because his brother is his father's favorite. Why does he want to sell himself as a slave in chapter 44? It is because his brother is his father's favorite. Judah is a profoundly changed man. He starts off as a really crooked individual, focused on himself, willing to do terrible things to get what he wants. By the end of chapter 44, he is statesmanlike and willing to sacrifice himself for the good of another. He's learned the art of other person-centered, self-giving love. Now, the Judah origin story matters so much because it is from Judah that the kings of Israel will come. And even more than that, it is from Judah that Jesus Christ will eventually come. And so this moment of redemption in Judah's life looks like Jesus, doesn't it? Look at chapter 44, verse 33. Now then, please let your servant remain here as my Lord's slave in place of the boy, and let the boy return with his brothers. How can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? No, do not let me see the misery that would come on my father. Verse 34 would be an interesting one to reflect on in terms of thinking about how much God loves his people. But just think about verse 33. Judah wants to act as a substitute, as a sacrifice for his brother. This is the origin story at the beginning of the origin story of Jesus. Judah, Jesus' great ancestor, from whom his people take their name, is one willing to give his life in the place of another. Which is very beautiful. Now, in terms of what's going on in the story, you can see progress with Joseph too. And it's a progress of emotional intensity. So in chapter 42, when he hears them saying these things about what they did to him, verse 24, he turned away from them and began to weep, but then came back and spoke to them again. Then when he meets Benjamin in chapter 43, verse 29, and he says, is this your younger brother, the one you told me about? And he said, God be gracious to you, my son. Deeply moved at the sight of his brother, Joseph hurried out and looked for a place to weep. He went into his private room and wept there, and after he'd washed his face, he came out. So he's kind of weeping in front of the brothers and sort of turning his face and wiping his eyes. And then in chapter 43, he's so moved that he has to go and cry in another room and then wash his face before he comes out with them. So moved is he by what has happened in him being united or reunited with Benjamin, the only other son of his mother, Rachel. But if we can cheat and look at the very first verses of chapter 45, look what happens as a result of Judah's little speech. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, have everyone leave my presence. So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers, and he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about it. And Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Is my father still living? But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. We come back to the fear. Now they actually know who they're dealing with. We'll find out in chapter 45 why they came not to be afraid in Joseph's presence. But two things. Here's the first. The wicked flee when no one pursues, A guilty conscience is a terrible thing to carry with you. And lots of us keep God at arm's length because there are things in our lives and things in our hearts and things in our pasts of which we are deeply ashamed. And actually, we don't want God to get close to us because we think, if he knows that about me, he will never accept me. This astonishing story of reconciliation between Joseph and his brothers points to a much deeper, much bigger story of reconciliation between humanity and God. And what it says to us is you don't have to go through the rest of your life with a guilty conscience, terrified that at any moment God is going to finally let the hammer drop on you. Guilty conscience is like the old idea of the sword of Damocles that's going to fall, held up by a thread. And you go through your life thinking, I know that at some point I'm going to get what's coming. And every good thing that happens, you think, maybe somehow this good thing is going to be the means of my undoing. And you don't believe that God can or will bless you. My dear friends, Ben was absolutely right. When we confess our sins, it is a privilege because we are people who can come to Almighty God and say, look, this is the worst of it. And there's stuff in my heart that I don't even know about that's so much worse. But thank you that you have promised forgiveness. A clean conscience is part of the inheritance of every Christian. What you have taken and laid at the foot of the cross of Jesus is no longer yours to carry. That's the first thing. And here's the second. What we've seen through this story with Joseph so far and to this point is that God is at work slowly but surely to transform the brothers, and particularly Judah. This is like the origin story in reverse. And actually, this is what the film Groundhog Day is all about. Bill Murray begins by realizing there's no consequences to anything he does because the day just resets every morning. So he goes and does all the things that he desires, and that doesn't really fulfill him, and he begins to feel that's pretty empty. So he starts doing good things, and he starts trying to improve himself, and he starts learning to play the piano, and he starts learning to make ice sculptures, and he starts figuring out when bad things are going to happen to people during that day and sort of rescuing them and saving them. But none of that frees him from the loop that he's in. He's very attracted to his co-star, and he, all the way through the story, he's trying to, effectively he's trying to seduce her. And he thinks, maybe if I can just manage that, you know, I'll break out of the loop. And he tries all kinds of things. He tries telling her he loves her. He tries grand gestures. None of it works. But in the end, he gets to know her. And finally, actually falls in love with her. And he wakes up. And he hears Sonny and Cher on the radio. But then the banter is different. Now look, quick aside, the redemptive arc of most Hollywood stories is like that. It's about the redemptive power of romantic love. And it's a lie. Romantic love cannot save you. It is not the thing that ultimately will fulfill you and make you into the person you were made to be. Okay? It's a wonderful thing, but Hollywood is selling you a pup with almost every film that you watch. And that's true with Groundhog Day. It's got some brilliant ideas and brilliant themes in it, but in the end, the thing that's redemptive is not the thing you were made for. Because the thing you were made for is a relationship with the God who made you. And through the sort of grinding repetition of these chapters, what we're seeing is that God is at work to transform the characters of the brothers. And I think the reason I get so bored and annoyed in the music, well, there are more than one reason maybe, but is that actually this bit doesn't feel like it's going anywhere. The constant replacing of the silver and Joseph's cup and all that. But in this bit that feels like the doldrums. It doesn't feel like you're getting to the end of the story. It doesn't feel like you're getting to the point. Why can't they just go down and get the grain and then that's the end? It takes half an hour off the running time. But you see, in this, in the sort of grind and the repetition and the doldrums and the difficult things and the stuff the brothers don't want to have to go through, somehow, quietly and in the background, God is doing this wonderful work of making them more like himself. And you know, in the end, that is what God is committed to doing in your life. I think I spend so much of my time praying for the things I want to happen. I spend so much time. Waste so much time praying that my circumstances would change, that, you know, that things would be better. When actually, I think when you observe God at work close up in people's lives the way we have done in Genesis 37 following, actually what you see is that God is much more concerned to change your character than he is to change your circumstances. And that's true even when it comes to the new heavens and the new earth, I think. Because actually the point of heaven, as we call it in shorthand, is not that you get to be in a much better place. It's that you get to be in a perfect relationship with the perfect God who made you for himself. And so what God is busy doing in your life now is making you more like Jesus. He's transforming your character. That's the thing he wants for you more than anything. And I need to try to learn, when things in my life are hard, to pray that actually what God will do is that deep work in my heart and my soul to transform me to be like him. Actually, changing my circumstances would be incredibly easy for God, but he is committed to the much harder work, which is changing my character. Just listen to these words from the Apostle John as I close. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Okay, so you're already the children of God, but one day you'll be gloriously revealed as the children of God. When you see Jesus, you will be like him because you'll see him the way that he is. That is the redemptive arc of your life. God is going to make you what you were meant to be. And it will be more glorious, says John, than you can imagine. What we will be is not yet known. No one can fathom what it'll be, what you'll be like. It'll be glorious. But even now, because of that, we're being transformed to be more and more like Jesus. So the person who has this hope purifies themselves even as Jesus is pure. That's what Jesus wants for you. That's what God wants for your life, to make you like himself. And the astonishing thing is that often, quietly and in the background and through the grind and through all the things that you wish didn't happen, he is busy doing it. Which is brilliant news, because actually it means that the one who's really got the steering wheel is him and not me. And many of the things that have changed me most in my life have been the things that I didn't plan and I would never have chosen and I wished hadn't happened. And yet, in the midst of all of that, God was at work. May I lead us in a prayer. Father, we thank you that your gospel is so wonderful that actually we do not need to bear a guilty conscience, because Jesus has purified us. He has taken it all away. For those of us who struggle to let go of guilt, please, Father, help us by your Spirit to really believe that Jesus has done what he says he has done. And help us to leave it all at the foot of his cross. But Father, too, we pray you'll teach us to have your priorities for our lives. You want us to be like Jesus. You want to transform our characters. And Father, they were so often preoccupied with other things, we pray that you will teach us bit by bit to love what you love and to want what you want. And to be keen to be at work with you in seeing our hearts and our lives changed to be more what you meant them to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's continue in prayer. Lord, we pray for our world. There are so many people suffering. We pray for the victims of the cyclone in New Zealand, and we especially pray, Heavenly Father, for the situation in Turkey and Syria after the earthquake nearly 2 weeks ago. Lord, with over 46,000 known to be dead and the toll still rising daily, we pray for all those affected. Please comfort those who mourn, bring healing to the injured, and strength and resilience to all of those involved in the rescue teams. Lord, please help any remaining survivors to be found swiftly and for the right aid to arrive to those who need it in these countries so that basic human needs can be met. Lord, with the anniversary of Russia's invasion of the Ukraine next week, we continue to pray for peace, reconciliation, and comfort for all who do not know what tomorrow will bring. Lord, may your kingdom come and your will be done. Lord, please be with all, especially the children and the vulnerable who are suffering as the crisis continues. Lord, we lift up those to you, those who are anxious and fearful, for those who are bereaved, injured, or who have lost their lives. And Lord, we pray for those in positions of authority and power. Please open their hearts to your voice so that you can guide them on the path to peace and restoration. Lord, we pray for our country, our king, and our government. Lord, with so many families struggling with the increasing cost of living, we ask that our Prime Minister and government will have integrity and compassion in all they do. We pray that Christian MPs, peers, and staff will grow in their faith and seek to serve you, being salt and light in the Parliament. Please help those Christians working in Parliament to model disagreeing well and be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Lord, as King Charles prepares for his coronation later this year, we pray that he is listening to you. Lord, none of us can start to comprehend what life as monarch is like, but we ask, Lord, that King Charles be guided by you in all he does and not be distracted by the many media stories of his family's unrest. We thank you for his devotion to our nation, the Commonwealth, and this planet. And Lord, please help his relationship with you to grow daily. Amen. Lord, we pray for our young people, many of whom have attended the KO and Rooted weekend activities last and this weekend. Thank you for Stephen and the leaders for making the time for these activities and arranging so much fun alongside the great teaching of your word. Lord, for those who attended who are not regular churchgoers, may the seed of curiosity for you be growing in their hearts. Lord, for those that know you but may be questioning their faith, please help the weekends to have encouraged them to put their trust in you. And Lord, for those that already trust in you, we pray that their faith has been bolstered. Lord, we also pray for our young people taking exams at this time, be they mocks for formal qualifications in the summer or other progression exams. Lord, help them to still make time for you as they study and be with them, removing any anxieties at this time. And Lord, for those waiting on further education offers or working through what path the next phase of their life should take, we ask that you will be with them and bring them peace and comfort, helping them all to know that you have a plan for each of them. Lord, we pray for our church family students at the many different locations around the country. Keep them close to you, and for their love and knowledge of you to deepen. And Lord, please also help them to feel bold enough to share their faith with others who do not yet know you. Amen. And today we are praying for our mission partners off the fence who are working to restore the lives and hope of the homeless, women at risk, and vulnerable school children in Brighton and Hove. Lord, we pray for the team and the whole community as they adjust to the knowledge of Paul and Wendy moving on in 2024. We pray, Lord, that the right successors can be found to continue this important work. We pray for Paul and Wendy as they start to let go of Off the Fence. Lord, may you guide them in whatever your plan has next for them. We thank you, Lord, for Nick, who is joining the Antifreeze as Antifreeze deputy on Monday. May he fit into the team well and bring much needed support for this mission. We pray for the Big Woolly Hats fundraising event on the 24th of February. May there be a fantastic take-up, Lord, and that the event will be a hugely successful, raising plenty of funds. We pray for the schools team. We pray that half term has brought some rest and recuperation and renewed energy for all as they move into the second half of the term and the run-up to Easter. And we pray for the Gateway team. Lord, we pray that the new facilities are a real blessing and can be used to full advantage as the team develop a new timetable of face-to-face support for the vulnerable women they support. And finally, we pray for the core team, Lord, who provide support to all of the frontline teams. Please guide them to know how best to do this and to balance their time wisely. Amen. And Lord, we pray for those in our church family who are sick or struggling in any way at this time. Please send your healing hand to them. Keep them close to you now and always. And in a moment of quiet, let us pray for others known to us who currently need God's healing hand. Amen.
Thank you very much, Jane. We're going to finish our service by singing Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, where we will be praying rather and singing that we may help to look backwards and remember. That's what we mean when it says raising an Ebenezer, but also looking ahead and walking in step, tuning our hearts to sing God's grace. So please stand as we sing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, pour for songs of thou's praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, some by my heart, Lord.
Those words from John again. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Father, we thank you that you are working in us now to make us more like your Son, and we have the absolute constant hope that you will bring us home. Help us to live in that and walk in that this day and always. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with us all this day and forever. Amen.